Andy Gregory. Perhaps this isn't a murder at all. Perhaps since somebody died under suspicious circumstances and nobody was charged, this was a near-perfect murder. In perfect murders, of course, nobody's ever been suspected. Certainly, Inspector Askew said that he would have charged Maundy Gregory if the man hadn't retreated to France, leaving too little evidence for his extradition to be arranged. Anyway, we have a mystery, and a mystery involving one of the most remarkable English rogues of the 20th century. J. Maundy Gregory was a parson's son. "Parson's sons are always the worst," we used to say at school, without ever specifying what we meant by worst. And at school in Southampton, Gregory teamed up with another parson's son. Tiny Harold Jumbo Davidson, later to become a parson himself, and hilariously notorious as the rector of Stifkey. That ought to be pronounced Stukey, but Stifkey, the way it's written, is more fun to say. Harold Davidson, the prostitute's padre, was to declare that his own personal inspiration derived from Christ's attitude to the woman taken in adultery, and still more his close personal friendship with the notorious harlot of Magdala. What scriptural evidence is there, by the way, that Mary Magdalene was anything but a perfectly respectable, devout woman whose reputation has been sullied by traditional Christian prurience? Anyway, with this spiritual example in mind, the rector spent most of his time walking in Soho and Piccadilly, accosting very young and nubile waitresses, addressing them as Queen of my heart, and offering to put them on the stage. When his upright Norfolk parishioners objected to their rector bringing young ladies of indeterminate occupation to sleep in the rectory at Stifkey, the Bishop of Norwich took up their complaints and started solemn and expensive proceedings to have little Jumbo unfrocked. Davidson fought his case energetically and passionately, but with typically outrageous indiscretion, undermined his position by letting himself be photographed in a Soho flat, gazing with undisguised admiration upon a very young girl who'd stripped herself naked for his delectation. Unfrocked and penniless, he tried to persuade the world of his innocence by starting a fast unto death in a barrel, in full view of the public, in a shop window. It has been suggested that the public did not see certain large meals brought in by Confederates in the small hours of the morning. Kicked out of the shop, Davidson took his barrel to a sideshow on Blackpool's Golden Mile. And when this proved insufficiently amusing to raise money, he started lecturing on his wrongs and his innocence from a cage which he shared with an old and tired lion. Ultimately, the lion became bored and sank its teeth firmly into its tiresome roommate. The rector of Stifkey expired to the accompaniment of headlines even more ludicrous than those which had accompanied his trial. This richly comic character shared a passion for the stage with his old schoolmate Maundy Gregory, and early in their careers the two joined forces to promote a revival of the musical Dorothy. Its hit song was Queen of My Heart, the title which Davidson thereafter freely bestowed on a truly enormous number of attractive young women, which was very positive-minded of him, for he and Gregory lost their shirts on the show. Davidson had his living in Stifkey, with a handsome stipend of £800 a year to support him. Gregory had to turn to new ways of raising the wind. He had learnt from Davidson the necessary panache for a career as a confidence trickster. He avoided the irresistible impulse to sheer absurdity which undermined his mentor and fellow promoter, and he emerged in the years after the First World War as an apparently very rich man of power and influence. He owned the Ambassador Club, a successful operation that astutely doubled as a daytime gentleman's club for civil servants and politicians, offering a good luncheon with bad wine, and at night became a chic dancing and drinking club patronised by the Prince of Wales. With a good con man's ear for a phrase suggesting insider status and total discretion, Gregory always referred to the Prince as Number One when he booked a table. Gregory also owned the Whitehall Gazette, a newspaper that imitated the London Gazette, wherein service promotions and public honours are officially listed. Gregory's paper looked official, but was entirely unofficial. It had practically no subscribers and no sales. A print order of about 1,000 copies was almost entirely distributed as comps to centres of the establishment, embassies and respectable clubs like the Athenaeum. The Whitehall Gazette made a little money by publishing regular flattering features on men of the moment, from rich industrialists through aspiring politicians to Indian princelings. These instant celebrities paid Gregory generous sums of money to have their names thus brought to the attention of innocent diplomatists and senior clubmen who assumed that the complimentary copies of the Whitehall Gazette they found in respectable newspaper racks must have been purchased for some good reason. But the club and the newspaper were really a combination cover, front, and promotional stunt for Gregory's main covert business. So were the lavish Derby Day dinners he gave for very prominent people and politicians. Significantly, it was the more brilliant and individualistic politicians who preferred Gregory's company. Men who were not good and loyal lobby fodder and party liners. Men who seemed dangerously clever to the average plodders. Men like Winston Churchill and F.E. Smith. And these were also the men who, together with Arthur Balfour and Lord Curzon, favoured a coalition of government of outstanding talent, headed by the brilliant David Lloyd George, rather than the dull partisan governments of mediocrities lined up between Herbert Asquith, Bonar Law, and Ramsay MacDonald. Maundy Gregory probably never even met Lloyd George, but he was a very important cog in the Welsh wizard's scheme. Lloyd George's problem was that he had no great party and its bankroll behind him. To fight elections and keep himself in office, he urgently needed a big campaign fund. Maundy Gregory was the discreet Mr. Fixit who saw that really big money rolled into Lloyd George's fighting fund without rich industrialists having to offer public support for a man whose policies and personality they probably detested. Maundy Gregory offered a genuine quid pro quo. Titles. £10,000 down, as near as damn it in used notes and brown envelopes, would make you a knight. Not Mr. Hardface, man who did well out of the war, but Sir Hardface. Up the ante and you could be a baronet. So your son and grandson would collect the title as well, Sir Hardface the second and third. A good investment. A bit shame-making if it ever came out that you'd really received the accolade for slipping a whacking great tip into the back of Lloyd George's hand, and not for the publicly acclaimed service of supplying cheap jam or tin spoons to the army. But all perfectly legal. And pretty harmless so far, except for the distress it might cause people weak-minded enough to think that it matters tuppence whether Joe Bloggs is addressed as Joe, or Mr. Bloggs, or Sir Joseph Bloggs Bart. The problems came at the next stage up. For considerably larger sums of money you could buy a peerage, a barony, or maybe a viscountcy. Not even Lloyd George dared to flog earldoms or dukedoms. But the move from Daddy Warbucks to Lord Warbucks of Scrooge conferred some real power, lastingly, on what might be a pretty undistinguished family. For membership of the House of Lords gave a vote in the amending debates on real legislation, handed down through the generations. The older and politically more experienced aristocratic families, with traditions of noblesse oblige and a primary interest in the game laws, were alarmed by the possibility of irresponsible arrivists changing the nature of the House of Lords. Democrats, who disliked a hereditary legislative chamber anyway, were appalled, and Lloyd George's enemies were determined to stop him from amassing an effective fighting fund. Maundy Gregory was a completely professional covert operator. He indicated that he was quite willing to bend the club and the Gazette to the interests of any government or powerful political party that wanted to employ him, even, heaven bless us all, the wicked socialists. But it was of no avail. His honourable and discreet occupation was declared illegal. The sale of honours was made an offence. Maundy Gregory was a criminal from 1925 on. It made even greater discretion important. There could be no more of the tax evaders, dubious financiers, and actual convicted criminals who had been ennobled by Lloyd George. But there were still plenty of the 34,000 commoner war profiteers left to be milked, and Gregory assiduously went on milking them, and secretly buying honours through the Whip's office and the government party machines, until 1931. Then Stanley Baldwin stepped in. Baldwin had always been a little embarrassed that his family ironworks came out of the war richer than it went in. He had always stood for the safe mediocrities against the brilliant individualists. He set out to crush Gregory and prevent his recommendations from going through. He succeeded in imposing such delays that disaster struck Gregory when one of his clients died before his honour was awarded, and his executors sued Gregory for the return of £30,000 for which no services had apparently been rendered. Now, Gregory could have won a civil case hands down in court, proving that he'd pulled every string on his late client's behalf, and the title would almost certainly have been awarded had he lived. But that would have led to his own conviction under the Honours Prevention of Abuses Act and the exposure and ruin of his business. He had to reach a settlement, and he agreed to pay £3,000 dollops. Only he didn't possess £30,000 cash, and so, in desperation, he made one rash self-destroying move, and also, possibly, committed murder. The disastrous error Gregory made was to try and sell a title to Lieutenant Commander Edward Billyard Leake, an honest sailor who was perfectly content with the DSO his wartime services had earned him, and disbelieved Gregory's initial hint that the government might wish to raise it to a knighthood. When he found that Gregory was trafficking in honours, he simply turned him in and gave evidence against him. Gregory got 2 months in jail and a £50 fine. His great racket was over. But before going to jail, he made one other attempt to raise the wind. For several years, he'd been living with widowed Mrs. Edith Ross. She was not, as many people subsequently assumed, his wife, nor was she, as they often told landladies, his sister. Odder still, she was not his lover, for Gregory was devoutly homosexual. They really and truly were just good friends, and cohabitees, of course, occupying the same house, but with separate bedrooms. Gregory treated her with elaborate old-world charm, calling her Milady or Little Lady. They spent a good deal of time at a wooden bungalow in Thames Ditton, enjoying jaunts on the river in an electric canoe and a cabin cruiser. And Gregory advised Milady on her investments. So when the unremitting trustees had seriously narrowed his options, he turned to Milady with a request for a £10,000 loan. And, to his enormous surprise, she turned him down, claiming that she could not liquidate stock from which she drew her income without making a substantial loss. Gregory was horrified. Indeed, the lack of that money led directly to his downfall, compelling him to make the very imprudent approach to Billyard Leake. But all did not go well for Mrs. Ross after this contretemps. She fell ill. Sickness, diarrhoea and vomiting, the usual symptoms of a pesky tummy bug, or an irritant poison. Gregory was extremely solicitous. He had her attended by an amiable, if not overcompetent, doctor. A brief rest in a nursing home prompted a quick recovery. A return to Gregory's loving care and home nursing brought on a relapse. On the first day of her illness, a blazing August afternoon, with the doctor diagnosing heat stroke, Mrs. Ross announced her belief that she was dying, and asked Gregory to write something for her. And so, on the back of a restaurant menu card, Gregory wrote a will, leaving all Mrs. Ross's property to himself. A more suspicious-looking testament has never been seen. Yet the doctor and housekeeper who witnessed Mrs. Ross's signature both confirmed Gregory's claim that a perfectly sane Mrs. Ross had asked him to write at her dictation, utterly unprompted, and neither had any reason to lie. On the 14th of September 1931, Mrs. Ross died. Gregory spent the day in an extraordinary trek around Thameside villages, looking for one with a churchyard overlooking the river. He insisted that Mrs. Ross had loved the Thames so much that she wished to be buried within sight of it. Most parishes refused to accept the body. Picturesque churchyards are such desirable resting places that they would quickly be filled with jam and tin spoon manufacturers if the vestries did not reserve them for their own resident parishioners. But the parish of Bisham, softened by Gregory's desperate offer of £100 for charity, agreed to let Mrs. Ross lie at the water's edge. Nor did anyone quibble over Gregory's sentimental insistence that he could not bear to think of a great weight of earth laying on Milady. She was buried a mere 18 inches deep. But why had Gregory given himself so much trouble and anxiety, herring all over the Thames Valley in a taxi, when the bungalow in Thames Ditton gave Mrs. Ross every right to be buried there? Could it be because Thames Ditton graveyard stood a couple of hundred yards back from the river, so that water could not filter through the bank and into the nearby graves when the stream rose? Could he have wanted Mrs. Ross's body inundated as soon as possible? 3 years earlier, Gregory had told a friend that he'd obtained some curare, a South American vegetable poison. He was most excited by the fact that it would dissolve in water in the body, which meant that it could never be detected, and it could be used for the perfect murder. In the immediate aftermath of Mrs. Ross's death, however, other matters engaged everybody's attention. Gregory faced his court appearance over Billiard Leek's charge. He had the rum-looking will on the menu to prove, and he managed it in 3 weeks. And then he had his short prison sentence to serve. Having paid this debt to society, he moved quickly to France, taking Mrs. Ross's money with him, so that he was not available when the lady's niece decided that her aunt's will in her favour must have been clandestinely destroyed, and that her aunt's death was remarkably suspicious, and that the police must be alerted in a statement that ran to 60 pages. Gregory was living quietly in Paris when Mrs. Ross's body was exhumed from its scenic grave, and Dr. Roach Lynch, the Home Office analyst, stood by to take specimens of the organs and search them for poison. Gregory would not see how completely inundated her grave had been, so that water poured out of the coffin as it was raised, and Dr. Lynch, knowing that more poisons than curare dissolve and disappear under the circumstances, muttered gloomily, "Not a chance, not a bleeding chance." He was right. The examination proved that Mrs. Ross had not died of heat stroke or a tummy bug or even Bright's disease, as her last medical attendant had variously guessed. In fact, it was impossible to say what she died of. No trace of poison was found. But in that watery grave, this would have been true if she was stuffed to the gills with arsenic. Did Maundy Gregory get away with murder? His friends thought not. He had neither the nerve nor the heartlessness in their view. The police differed. Had he been in England, they would have charged him with murder. Maundy Gregory died peacefully in France without ever returning to his native land. Was he a murderer? The judgment of history hangs in the balance.